So it asks us to make sure I read the directions, graph it. Oh, and identify the x intercept. Okay, let's graph it first. This is one of those situations I may not have explicitly said what the x intercept is, but you certainly could figure it out. And I'll tell you in just a minute exactly what it is. So to graph this, right, we graphed many equations. Graphed many equations yesterday in this form, at least six, maybe a few more, okay, where we talked about this container filling with water, where the container was like the bottom of it was like on a little stand, so it started out a little bit higher, right? So let's try and use that analogy for this example. What does this equation tell me about the level of water in this container?
It starts at 9 inches.
Starts at 9 inches. So it could have a stand that's 9 inches tall, or I think what's maybe a little bit easier is that it starts out with 9 inches of water just already in there. That's how it's at 9 inches. Well, on the graph, that's going to look like this. 0 seconds, we have 9 inches of water. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9 inches right there. 0 seconds, we have 9 inches of water in the container already. It starts out that way. Okay. Now, we're going to follow the slope. The slope is this pattern of going over, right, to the right usually, and either up or down. Or we could go to the left and go up or down. We'll go forward, because it's a little easier to imagine what happens if you go forward in time than backward in time. So as you go forward, how far forward in the future are we going to go?
Three
whatevers, right? We'll call them seconds, 3 seconds. 3 seconds into the future. Every time you go 3 seconds into the future, what happens?
Go up 8 up and go up.
Go up 8?
When you go down 8, like take 8 inches away. Negative.
No, there's got to be something up with that negative, right? And we can think of it as either a negative 8 or a negative 3. Right now we're thinking of it as a negative 8 because 3 is positive. We move forward in time, 3 seconds, right? If we have a negative slope, a negative rate, okay, this is a rate. The rate is negative 8 inches every 3 seconds. Or negative 8 thirds of an inch every 1 second, but that's a little harder to graph. So we think of it in whole units. 3 seconds into the future, we lose 8 inches. So 3 seconds into the future, here we go, forward 3 inches into time, and we drop 8 inches. It's losing water pretty fast. Okay. So it's dropped out 8 inches, now we only have 1 inch left, right? And then it will continue to drop. The next 3 seconds, if it were possible to have negative water, we would go into having negative inches of water pretty quickly. Just keep going. And you know, this container thing I'm using as an analogy to help you understand why the graph looks the way that it does. Why the slope is this over and down or over and up thing, right? How it makes sense. So we give it a rate that applies to the situation, but it could be anything. It could be every 3 days you lose 8 trees to some kind of a beetle or a fungus or something. Okay, it could be that. Every 3 minutes, you lose $8. Every 3 hours, you lose $8. Every 3 days, you lose 8 pounds. Like, whatever it is, we see this go forward in time, lose something. Okay? Or, we could go backwards in time, which is a little harder to think about, but really, like, if we're watching this thing empty of water as time goes forward. If we go backwards in time, we rewind the video, what does it look like it's happening?
It's filling up.
Looks like that hole in the bottom is actually sucking water into it and it's filling up. Right? As we go backwards in time, the level of water goes up. As time is the negative thing, the level of water becomes the increase. As time is increasing, the inches are decreasing. Okay. Right? A negative rate takes a negative slope means we're dropping, right? We're dropping down, we're losing stuff, right? So I just said a lot of words. Do those words make sense?
Yeah.
Did that make sense?
Yeah.
Question, Sid?
So
So, what do we, where do we put the eight of?
You just go combine it.
So the eight is the going down.
So you.
Going down eight.
What's the X intercept?
The X intercept, we'll answer that in just a second.
This is a question, but in the long run, I did 4.2.
Well, if you fill out a pink slip, there's actually a box that says I did the wrong section.
Okay.
So often.
Yeah, I turned it in and I just realized that.
Well, it would have looked pretty funny. So I sent it back. So, yeah, do 4.4, turn it in, no late penalty, we do. All right, so that's a negative slope. As we go forward, right, in the right, in the horizontal direction, we go forward, we go down. Losing stuff is kind of good. Ready for the, the x-intercept. Okay, the y-intercept is this guy right here. Okay? It's a point on the y-axis. Every point on the y-axis, other than being on the y-axis, right, it has something in common. What do they all have in common? Every point on the y-axis, what does it have in common with every other point on the y-axis? Mind.
What do you mean?
Well, any point that, the y-intercept is a point on the y-axis. Every point on the y-axis has this thing in common.
Is the name of the x is 0?
There we go. We can put that a lot of different ways. Saying that it's on the y-axis is just a way of saying that x is 0. We're not over here where x is positive. We're not over here where x is negative. We're not to the right, we're not to the left, right in the middle. We're right in the middle, then x is 0. That's the y-intercept, and a y-intercept is saying that this is the y-intercept is basically a way of saying x is 0 for this point. Okay. X is 0. So we have 0 comma 9. Well, if x is 0 for a y-intercept, then for an x-intercept, which is right here, then what would you say about that point? Y is 0. The y is 0. So this is question mark comma 0 for sure. It's a 0 for y, right? Because it's not a point up here where y's are positive. It's not a point down here where y's are negative. It's right in the middle. That's right here where y is 0. So I just take this equation, right? Y, I'm going to rewrite it because it's a mess right there up at the top. And I make y 0. And now x is the only variable. I solve for the unknown variable. That's what algebra is all about. Subtract 9 from both sides, you got negative 9. Negative 9 equals negative 8/3 x. How am I going to cancel out that negative 8/3 from that side of the x? It's negative 8/3 times x. Hallie had a full hand raise first. Go ahead.
Divide by negative 8/3.
Divide by negative 8/3. Can anybody tell me an easy way to divide by negative 8/3? Well, it's going to be a negative number to multiply by the reciprocal, right? So the reciprocal of negative 8/3 is negative 3/8. Okay. So this is great. This is going to be just x, 1x. This side is going to be, negative times negative first. What's negative times negative?
Positive.
So I know that the answer is going to be positive. So let's just keep that in mind. We're going to have 3 times 9.
27
over 8 times 1, 80. Okay, 27/8. That's where it hits the x-axis. X-axis. Right there, this is, now we know, 27/8. That's the x-intercept. So y-intercept, x is 0, x-intercept, y is 0. Make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Page 7. There we go, number 20, whatever was next, 23, then 24. Okay. Well, I'll just say, I think this makes sense. This whole situation right here is one where this would start out with how much water?
Four.
4 inches, right? That's the part that's not multiplied by x, so when we put in 0, that's gonna still be 4, right? And from there, we're going to subtract some, right? Subtract something, so we're losing water, right? So we have a starting point of 4, and we're losing water over time, right? How much water are you losing over how much time?
Three seconds? 3 inches
every 5 seconds. We're losing 3 inches every 5 seconds, right? If I were to plug 5 in there, 5 seconds, 5 divided by 5, that's canceled out. We got a 1 down, -3. Yeah, we're losing 3 after 5 seconds. So maybe if I reread it like this, it could look more familiar to you.
Yeah.
Those are the same, right? I've got a -3/5 x, that's one of the numbers. I've got a +4, that's another number. I'm adding them together. So I just switch the order around. 2 + 3 is the same as 3 + 2. 1 + 5 is the same as 5 + 1. Just switching the order of the addition. It's called the commutative property of addition. So it's the same. If I were to look at this equation, it's the same as this equation. It starts out at 4. Starts out at 4. And then what seconds later?
5 seconds
later. 1, 2, 3, 4. 5 seconds later.
Then down 3.
It goes down 3 inches. 1, 2, 3 inches. There it is. My x-axis is pretty crooked, so let's fix that.
Bob called you.
So 5 seconds later, it drops 3 inches, which means we're down to 1 inch of water. We started out with $4, and 5 hours later, we lost $3, and now we're down to $1. Or we started at 5 pounds overweight, and then 5 weeks later, we lost 3 pounds, and now we're just 1 pound overweight. It could mean anything. It could mean anything at all. But it does need to mean that as the x increases, the y decreases. Whatever x and y might represent. Question?
Okay. So, I'll graph fractions.
If we were to graph, we haven't graphed any fractions, but if you were, okay, if you were to.
Oh, no,
let's start with it. Let's say we're going to graph like 1/2, 2. Maybe 2 is a bad choice. There'd be 2 right there. Let's do like 3.
1, 2, 3.
I'm just going to graph that point 1/2, 3. Well, let's mark off some points. There's some hash marks here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. There's -1, -2, -3, -4, -5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, so I'm going to graph this 1/2, 3. Well, here is 1, right? And this is 2, and this is 3, and so on. So if this is 1, where's 1/2?
In the middle.
Here's 0, here's 1, 1/2 is right in between.
Yeah.
1/2, 3. Does that answer your question? Okay, so what we really have here is 2 number lines. You graph number lines before since you were in like, third grade, number lines?
Yeah.
Point on the number line.
Box
of whiskers.
This is a number line?
I don't even know
right?
what life was in
the
third grade,
man.
I believe.
Oh my gosh. I don't even remember.
Here's a number line. Here's a number line. It's just 2 number lines, right? So this point is keeping track of a value on this horizontal number line and this vertical number line. And the horizontal number line is telling you it's at 1/2. The vertical is telling you 3. So you graph fractions on these number lines just like you did on the number lines when you were kids, even though to me, you're also kids, of course.
We ain't kids.
Yeah, well.
I could fight you and I could win. I mean, I ain't kid.
I'm 2 years my age.
Fighting me doesn't make you not a kid.
Hunter, you cannot be.
It makes you unwise.
Hunter, you would lose.
Oh, bring him in.
He would body slam you.
You would have managed it.
Alright. So, thank you for your support. Okay, so we're coming to a harvest festival, which will naturally have a banner above it. It says festival, probably in all caps, hopefully not in Comic Sans. And there's a fence around it.
Oh, it's like a nice pretty effect.
And there's a person standing. This isn't the person, this is their little podium.
Get the
person
is
standing, but their head's too small, and they have legs and arms.
That's actually pretty good. That's
well,
awesome
yeah,
job.
This person says hello to you, here you are. You
have
I don't know if you have your books open or maybe you just remember from reading. How much does it cost to get into this place?
$5.
You just have to give them $5 right off the bat. So if you buy, if you get no apples, right, but you paid to get in here, then how much does it cost you?
$5.
Still $5, okay? That's a starting point. That starts our festival experience with $5 for no apples at all, right? So if we look at the graph, it would be starting up here at five. Okay. Now, once you get in here, where all the trees are, like a big row of trees.
It's raining.
It's like a cloud of trees with all these apples in them. So you go in there and you pick some apples. How much does it cost?
75 cents.
75 cents for what? An apple?
Yeah.
A pound of apples, which isn't a whole lot more than one apple, unless they're tiny apples. So we started at $5 to get in. It's 75 cents per pound. And so every time I pick 1 pound, these are pounds, every time I pick 1 pound, what happens?
You pay 75 cents.
So since we're at a positive five, we're probably trying to keep track of how much we paid, right? We're going to pay more, right? So 1 pound goes into a basket, right? And I pay 75 cents more. That's going to put me here at $5.75. So when you hear something per something else, dollars per pound, cents per pound, what's that called?
What?
Right?
No.
Starts with an R?
Rate.
That's the rate. That's the rate of increase of the cost to you.
Okay?
That's the rate of your spending. You spend 75 cents every 1 pound. So what's the equation going to look like? Y equals what?
$5.
Plus 75 cents
x.
75 cents x. Perfect. Or you may have written this. But that's the same thing. So it starts at 5, and then we have a rate, which when we graph it as a line, right, we graph this equation as a line, that rate becomes a, do I remember what the rate becomes when you look at the
slope?
Yeah, the slope of the line.
Oh boy.
The slope of the line. So here's a, I'm going to draw this pretty well. Let's try and do the line tool. Okay, so 1 pound, 75 more cents. How do you write 75, 0.75 as a fraction?
3/4.
Okay, now, so I can think of this as 75 cents every pound, or I can think of it as $3 every...
4 cents.
It's not seconds in this case.
Pounds.
4 pounds. $3 every 4 pounds. So I could go over one pound and go up 75 cents, or go over 4 pounds and go up $3. Let's see how well I drew this graph. Okay. Closer, if you can believe that's at 4, 4, what?
8.
It started at 5. It started at $5. I picked 4 pounds, and it goes up 3 more dollars, so we're at $8. Which is a lot easier to graph. And if I started that way, I bet I'd have a more accurate graph than trying to figure out where 0.75 is exactly. It's easier to figure out where exactly 4 is and where exactly 3 is, or 8, right, than to figure out 0.75 is somewhere in the middle. Any more questions? It asks us to choose between the two. We picked correctly, we graphed, we're done. Good. We got a rate times our variable x plus the beginning amount. Hunter?
Can you go back to 23?
So what's that bottom point?
This one right here?
Yeah.
Like, where is it?
Yeah, what is it? What? Yeah.
The coordinates? Well, it started out here at 4. We moved to the right 5. And we moved up a negative 3. Up a negative 3, right, means down. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Well, up a negative, that means down. So we went to the right 5 and went down 3. We started at 4. So we went to the right 5, so that's the x, that's 5. It's at 5, comma. Well, we were at 4, we went down 3, so that must be 1.
What would be the equation? So how do you solve that, like, actual equation solving?
Well, the x is 5, right? So I would just throw that in the equation. 4 minus 3 fifths times an x of 5. Y equals 4 minus 5 divides 5. We're left with 1. 4 minus 3. And y equals 1.
Okay. So then what if you replace x with 10?
Well, that would put us 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, somewhere out here, right? Which I can see from the graph. I should wind up with a negative. If I move to the right 5 more, I should move down 3 more and put me down here. If I move down 3 from here, I'm at 1. I move down 3 from there, I'm at negative 2. So if we plug that in, we should get negative 2. 4 minus 3 fifths times 10 over 1. Y equals 5 divides 10, that's 2. 4 minus 6 equals negative 2, just like we thought we should. Yeah.
-2 on the same
stuff.
So graph -2 and 10.
Well, my graph is not so good, like in the scale is a little off, but that should be that point right there that's 5 more to the right and down 3 from here. It should be right there at 10, -2.
Why is it? So, on every graph that you do this, do you start on the whole number? Since it's like plus 4, you always start at your dot on 4?
Yeah, that's what I would do just to make it fast. I would start here on the y-axis with 4. If I plug in 0, I'll get 4 for y. And then go from there, follow the slope from there.
Okay.
And you can follow the slope from any point. You can start here, follow the slope from there. Go to the right 5 and down 3. You can go back 5 and go up 3. Everything out? Okay. If you ever feel like you maybe don't quite remember how to graph a line in the way that we've been talking about, always fall back on plug in something for x and get something out for y. Okay? As long as your math is on, you'll never get it wrong. So if you feel like you can't remember, maybe it's been a couple of days or weeks, and you're not quite sure, you feel like you're getting something backwards or whatever, plug something in for x and find a y.
Well, I know what I did wrong. I put the 2 in a positive spot instead of a negative spot.
I saw that.
Yeah.
So now, this here, this method really is just plugging something in for x and getting something out for y, but just doing it. Just following a pattern of every time you graph a line in that way, this always happens. Here's what always happens. We plug in a what for x? What's the easiest thing to plug in?
Oh,
0, right? But I don't have to do any of the work. I plug in 0 for x, what will I get for y?
Negative 2.
Right, 0 minus 2, negative 2. If you can't remember, if you're like, there's a negative 2, does that mean I put it here or here? then don't do anything. Just plug in zero for x and see what happens, okay? It'll do more good for you than getting lucky because you just happen to remember it correctly, okay? So if you feel like you're forgetting, plug in zero for x and see what happens. If you do, you'll get -2.
All right.
Now, I'm gonna do the next part quickly and then explain how plugging something in for x could remind me. I'll move to the right 5 and I'll move down 3. Right 5 and down 3. If you did the opposite in both respects and moved back 5 and up 3, it's the same thing. Oh, good. So whether I move forward 5 and down 3 or back 5 and up 3, I'm still going to get, look, the same line. So again, if you feel like I can't remember if I'm supposed to go to the right 5 or I'm supposed to go to the right 3, I can't remember if I'm supposed to go up, I can't remember if I'm supposed to go down. All of our work yesterday was to try and help that make that more intuitive. All right, because we see it as a rate. We see it as a rate of like losing 3 inches every 5 seconds, right? Seeing it as a rate and seeing that happen on the line. But if you forget, what should you do if you think you feel like you're forgetting, you're not quite
plug
sure?
Plug in zero.
Plug in zero.
Plug in something for x and get a point, right? Plug in zero is the best one to plug in. It's the easiest. Okay. What would be if I feel like I'm forgetting about the slope? What can I plug in for x? That would be the easiest thing to plug in for x after 0.
5,
right? Because I can see the 5 is going to divide that 5. That's why we moved to the right 5. That's why we're moving to the right 5, because it's the easiest one. Move to the right 5, right? And then you get to move down a whole amount. Move down all of 3 instead of a decimal or a fraction. So if you forget that you're supposed to move to the right 5 and down 3 because every 5 seconds you lose 3 inches of water, just plug in something for x. Plug in 5 for x, 10 for x, 15. Right? And if I did that, 3, 5, 5, 1, 2, 5 divides 5, we left with the -3 minus 2 is a -5, right? So we know that 5, -5, and look, there it is, 5, -5.
Whoa.
Or -5. Plug in -5 and you'll get 1. So if you feel like forgetting, don't just guess and hope that you're right. Plug something in for x. You'll never go wrong. As long as your math is correct, you'll never go wrong. Okay? I wouldn't want to be the student who's there forever, and that's the only way they ever graph anything, because then more complicated graphs are going to take longer to get there, right? When I, in the future, want to graph a parabola, okay? I can graph random points, right? If I graph a point here and here, here, and I get one here, and there's one over there, and one over there, you're starting to see what this parabola should look like? Yeah, it should be upside down, and what this one looks like, right? It should look like this. But I don't want to graph that many points every time I graph a parabola. When I graph a parabola, I want to know how to most easily find key points. Here's a key point right here. The very bottom or the very top. Okay? The vertex. We want to graph that vertex. And then we just want a couple other points, like this one, and then I know that it's symmetrical, so I can put a point over there as well. 3 points. Really 2 points, and one of them just gets reflected over the line of symmetry. Right? So we're saying there are nice little shortcuts that we can learn if we put in a lot of effort and time and work and practice. If we put in minimal practice, then we're going to be minimally competence. But if you're forgetting, if you feel like you're forgetting, you're getting things backwards, go back to plugging things in for x. Go back to plugging things in for x. Alright, any questions? If you didn't get that one, crack open your book once this weekend, try a couple of problems, check the back of the book and see if you get it right. Google, graphing problems and slope intercept form and practice. Oh, I know about Google, yeah, I heard of it.